Yes, it is. It's my right hand and my left.
The congregation, please stand. We meet in the name of Jesus Christ, who died and was raised to the glory of God the Father. Grace and mercy be with you all. We have come here today to remember before God our brother Ian, to give thanks for his life, to commend his body to God, our merciful Redeemer and Judge, to commit his body to be cremated, and to comfort one another in our grief. So as we are, let us pray. God of all consolation, your Son, Jesus Christ, was moved to tears at the grave of Lazarus, his friend. Look with compassion on your children in their loss. Give to troubled hearts the light of hope, and strengthen in us the gift of faith. In Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Ian was a very enthusiastic singer, so I am hoping that we will fill this church with joy this afternoon as we sing our opening hymn, Guide Me, O Thou Great Redeemer. I don't think he would be disappointed with that rendition. We sit to hear Ian remembered.
We'll start again. Is that better?
Yes.
Thank you very much for telling me. I wouldn't want to waste my breath. Ian, deeply loved husband, dad, granddad, and very dear friend to so many. How can we possibly hope in a few short moments to do justice to the memory of such a man who led such a full, exuberant, positive, and faith-filled life? But we'll do our best. Ian Fraser Williams was born in Leicester on the 7th of June 1933 the only child of Lily and George, George being a very proud Scot. 6 weeks later, the family moved to Chelmsford, where Ian lived until he went away to university to study chemistry, except for a time when at the tender age of just 7, he was evacuated to the Lake District. But was he daunted by being uprooted from everything he had known since birth? No. He remembered it as a positive experience overall. Many of us here knew Ian as a man of deep faith, but he wasn't nurtured in the church. However, he was baptised in the Crown Court Scottish Presbyterian Church in central London by a friend of his father. His first significant introduction was at school, which in those days included daily worship and Christian teaching. Later, he became involved with Boys Brigade Christian camps, mainly on the Norfolk Broads, building on his sailing experience. And he soon became a leader in this formative environment, and his interest in faith went on growing. At one point, under the influence of a school friend, he even joined the Plymouth Brethren for a while. After university, Ian made a long and successful career for himself in the chemical industry. His work, ranging from cleaning cows' udders to metal finishing, and a great deal more besides. And now it's time to hand over to Ian's daughter, Jo, for her personal thoughts and memories.
Ian, my dad, met my mother, Julie, at a party when they were both living in shared flats in Earl's Court, and they married in 1958 when he was about 25. Unfortunately, the marriage didn't last, and they separated about 6 years later when I was 4. This doesn't sound promising, but things turned out well for Dad and for me. I feel lucky to have had him as my dad. Amongst his many good qualities, he has been a reliable and steadfast presence throughout my life. Dad had a knack with children, and certainly with me. He could turn tasks into shared enjoyment. Once a week, when my mother was out, we made instant whip. Dad gave me the impression that I was making it, standing on a chair, whisking the mixture, while he stood behind, apparently just helping. On one occasion, he arrived on his motorbike to pick me up from the childminder and wheeled it home with me, aged 3 or 4, sitting on it, which was a delight that I can still remember. Initially, after the separation, he lodged with a friend in Kilburn and then got a flat and a lodger in Enfield. One of his lodgers, Joachim, became a lifelong friend. Dad kept amicable contact with my mother and close contact with me. I spent every other weekend with him until I moved too far away. We spent most of our shared weekends at his parents' house until he married Jill in 1968. The journeys to and fro were part of the fun for me, with I Spy type games, but also a lot of learning. It's thanks to Dad that I understand the basics of binary counting and can recognize Orion in the night sky because of a regular stop for fish and chips on the way to the South Coast on Friday evenings. During these years, Dad was working as an industrial chemist, but he was also involved in amateur dramatics with another lifelong friend, Robin, and Scottish dancing. I remember being at someone's flat and watching, astonished, as grown-ups practiced their Highland sword dancing around 2 wooden-handled dish mops on the floor. At some point, he was supposed to move to Norway for work, and so he learned to ice skate. I was so relieved that it didn't happen, and maybe he was too. When I went to boarding school in Yorkshire, he visited me and took me out for leave weekends, and we explored some wonderful places together. He recently talked to me of the difficulty of finding us both something to do on a wet Saturday afternoon in Leeds. I can't remember what he came up with. I remember the fun things, like going down the Blue John mines or climbing on the Buttertub rocks. or driving across moors and nearly getting stuck on Mantor in a snowstorm. When I bought my first flat with a friend, Dad turned up unexpectedly on the day we moved in with champagne and two glasses for us. And when the roof of my bedroom in that flat started leaking, Dad, of course, responded to my phone call by coming to London and fixing it with me. And much later, when my maternal grandfather died, one of the few people that Dad really didn't get on with, he offered to come with me to the funeral because he understood that I needed support. Dad had great creativity that he used everywhere, and a capacity to make the most of things, fix things, do things, be grateful for what he had and do something with that. I can remember an engine sitting on the kitchen table, him fixing it, my mother not best pleased. Later, I remember sewing the rear windscreen of his Triumph Herald back in place, him outside and me inside, each with a needle and thread, passing them back and forth and securing it. His creativity and energetic engagement with things was really apparent when he married Jill and invested so much of himself into his life with her and Michael, with ambitious and successful DIY projects in the house and garden. I just accepted this as a child, but as an adult, I wondered, and I still do, how did he know how to do all of that? And where did he get all this remarkable energy and capacity to keep going, even if something didn't work out as planned? Alongside all of this was full-time work, church, other outside interests, and time with family and friends, at least one party a year at the house or in the garden. Dad's capacity to make the most of opportunities continued into my adulthood. In the 1980s, he had to go to Israel for work, and as Jill couldn't go with him, he invited me. It felt like such a great adventure being there, staying on a kibbutz, with a weekend trip which included him ignoring his awful vertigo to travel in a cable car up to the top of Masada and having to overcome his fear again to complete a walk along a scary wooden walkway on the side of the mountain. Very near the end of his life, Dad told me that he was content, that he had had a good life. And I believe him. That Dad had a rich life was in large part due to how he was. Committed, thoughtful, generous with time and effort, sociable, creative, resilient, and fun. I've been very lucky to have had him for my father. And I'm grateful. Thank you.
Thank you, Jo. That was wonderful. I feel privileged to have heard that. After his first marriage broke up, Ian joined the InterVarsity Club to find new friends and activities, including, as we've heard, amateur dramatics and membership of a Scottish dancing club. Jill was also a member. At first, they became just very good friends with a group of other dancers, but when the group was invited to a regimental ball, and Ian and Jill found themselves dancing rather close together, Ian in his swirling kilt and frothy lace, and Jill doubtless looking glamorous as she always does, boom, they suddenly fell in love, just like that. It was a love that was to last a lifetime. Jill told me Ian was witty and supportive and fun, and she would always rather dance and flirt with him than with any other dancer, ever. All through their married life, as long as was humanly possible, and probably a bit beyond, they carried on Scottish dancing as members of the Pot and End Club. My late husband John and I joined that club when we got engaged, and I remember Ian as a brilliant MC. He always made it fun. And although he was a marvellous dancer in that swirling kilt of his, he was very kind and extremely patient with us bumbling newbies. Just before their marriage in 1968, Ian wrote a musical with his best man, Robin, Girl in a Million, which they put on in the theatre in Herne Bay, and great fun was had by all. The newlyweds moved into their much-loved home, historic Northcote, in Green End Road. As we already heard from Joe, Ian was extremely skillful with his hands, adept at anything, from creating a swan out of an apple, and I've seen the photograph, to plumbing and rewiring. He began the renovations in earnest, and together, they created their beautiful garden. Both keen gardeners, they became long-standing members of the Berkhamsted Gardening Club and also of the Berkhamsted Music Society, going to many concerts year on year. In due time, Jill became pregnant. But their joy turned to sorrow when their much-longed-for baby daughter died before birth at 8 months, and Jill nearly lost her own life as well. But just over 2 years later, in 1971, their sorrow turned to joy after the safe delivery of their beloved son, Michael. His baptism here at St. John's was a most joyous family occasion, with baby Michael being carried by his sister, Jo. And it's time now to hear what Michael would like to share with us.
My memories of Dad from when I was little have faded away a bit as I've grown older. But when I was little, his work often kept him late. But when he was at home, he was always present. I have a lot of fond memories from when we went on family holidays. We stayed at the YMCA hotel in Lowestoft for a number of years, and I remember him entering the sand sculpting competition each year and being very impressed with his abilities. I also remember throwing eggs to each other across a beach and then trying to catch them without breaking them, and not trying to hit each other with them, obviously. After Lowestoft, we holidayed at Lee Abbey in North Devon for a number of years. And it was a place that always held a special place in Dad's heart and in mine. One year, just he and I went down there to help them rebuild their fences and replant trees after the spring storms had devastated them. And that is indicative of the man I remember, who was always willing to help out others. I remember him as a very practical man, and I looked up to him for his abilities. He put the central heating system in at our house, although he did also put his foot through the ceiling while doing so. He did then repair that as well. He built the bed that Mum and Dad used for the whole of their lives. He built a carport for parking the car, which suddenly became very important again just before he passed on. And when the house was extended, we built the patio and the retaining wall together. It was something that we shared. I learnt a lot from him. Many of the kind cards we've received have mentioned how many practical projects Dad helped out with. I learned so much from him while doing these projects around the house with him, and he helped me learn how to first maintain my bike and then later my car. And whenever I have a DIY problem, Dad will always be my first port of call. He loved driving, and he passed that love on to me. Our times in the car are times I remember with fondness, even when he did things like trick me that he could control the windscreen wipers with his mind. Intermittent wipers were a new thing back then. When I was older, he would pick me up from events, and we used to have good chats on those trips, and he would help me with any issues I was having. It was on one of those trips that I told him that I had met Rosemary and that I wanted to move in with her. He loved Rosemary. He thought that she was very good for me, and he thought Rosemary was a great mother to his grandchildren, Joshua and Daniel. He was very impressed that Rosemary managed to get both a degree and then a master's while bringing up our children. Rosemary has said that without his and my mum's support, it would have almost been impossible for her to do this. As a person, she found him to be very funny, and he was good at reflecting with her and open to exploring an idea. She also enjoyed watching his face light up when he talked about his early years. And Rosemary felt very honoured to be able to give him grandchildren, and he really enjoyed the fun of being a granddad. Both Joshua and Daniel have fond memories of their granddad. Daniel said that he was very kind and that he always tried his best when he wasn't well. Joshua said that he was easy to talk to and good at making him feel that everything was going to be all right. They both remember fun park trips and other outings, and Granny and Grandpa coming and babysitting them. Joshua has particularly fond memories of going to Fairlands Valley Park and having open sandwiches for lunch. Dad would always get down on the floor with them and play their games, and he loved constructing things out of Lego and connects with them. Dad was also invaluable during lockdown as he supported us with Daniel's schooling by doing Zoom school for part of the day every day with Daniel. This was despite having to master the new technology. And his love of math seemed to have been passed on to both Joshua and Daniel. What have I learned from him? To be loving and supportive, to go out of my way for others, and that I can do anything if I really want to, if I really apply myself. My dad loved all his family, and we're all going to miss him, but know that he has gone to a better place.
Thank you, Michael. Thank you very much. Jill and Ian had joined St. John's here very shortly after their marriage due to the machinations of Jill's formidable great-aunt Dora. Aunt Dora was well acquainted with Derek Jackson, the vicar here at that time, and she instructed him to call at once on this young couple who had just moved into his parish, call on them at once, and invite them most strongly to join his flock. Aunt Dora was not to be gainsaid, and from then on, St. John's became, in Jill's words, the foundation stone of our lives. And we all say, thank you, Great Aunt Dora and Derek Jackson. Not only did St. John's become their foundation stone, they became two of its strongest pillars. And wonderful friends and supporters to many of us over here for many years, including me. I will always be deeply grateful to them. And it's an honor to be speaking about Ian today and to still have the friendship of you, Jill. Their contributions to church life were many and various over the years, some together and some separately. Together, they did baptism preparation and Sunday school teaching, which became a particularly challenging task when they took on the older group. They also held leading roles in the prayer and healing groups and the listening ministry, for which they undertook training. And let's not forget the friendship teas which they started, and where Ian was known as Sandwich King. He went on making those delicious, delicate sandwiches, even when he was no longer able to stand. On Sunday mornings, he was an intercessor, spending much time preparing and really hitting the spot with his prayers. He was also one of the first lay people to be appointed as a chalice assistant. Administering the sacrament was a ministry he told me he valued very highly indeed. Ian's spiritual life underpinned everything he did, whether apparently secular or more obviously church-based. Outside the boundaries of parish life, he threw himself into many other activities, both in a wider Christian context and beyond. As we heard from Michael, they'd taken holidays at Lee Abbey, a wonderful Christian holiday centre in the stunning countryside of North Devon. And there, the faith of all three of them was both broadened and deepened. Ian worked for the diocese, one of his roles being on the Board of Finance. He was also a prison visitor at Her Majesty's Prison in Bovingdon, involved in parole decisions affecting the lives of the young offenders. He was a volunteer at the Mustard Seed Christian Bookshop and one of the founders and leaders of DENS, the local emergency night shelter for the homeless, a project which moved both Ian and Jill to great compassion and action. They were deeply involved in churches together in Hemel, including one spectacular Easter mission in Gaybridge Park many years ago, with marquees and busloads of children and young people from all over Hemel. On the first day, it snowed, and the ground was turned to mud and slush, and some of the more faint-hearted were all for cancelling the second day. But Ian and Jill and some other stalwarts set about praying for a miracle, and they all carried on. Ian and another couple of the men stayed up all night guarding the site. And on the second day, there were even more young people there than on the first. The power of prayer, as Ian would say. Spine-tingling stuff. They were involved in the monthly Saturday prayer breakfasts known as Pray Hemel, and gave out hot cross buns on Good Friday morning in Marlowe's year after year to shoppers and passers-by during the Good Friday procession of witness and the ecumenical service. I don't know how, but as well as all of this activity, Ian found time to take on the chairmanship of Probus and volunteer together with Jill as a theatre usher at the Swan in High Wycombe. and he and Jill also enjoyed mountain walking and travelling. For Ian, the three Fs were paramount: faith, family, and friends. His family, Jill, Joe and Andy, Michael and Rosemary, and grandsons Joshua and Daniel, meant the world to him. And during his illness, they were pivotal. During lockdown, regular conversations on Zoom, including the virtual homeschooling, really kept him going. It was wonderful that in his last days, he was at home in the sunshine, and they could all come and say their loving goodbyes. It goes without saying that Ian will be desperately missed, but what a legacy he leaves. And now, as we come to our time of reflection, Jill is going to read a prayer, which she will introduce herself. And after that, we're invited to listen to some of Ian's favorite music, the Hebrides Overture by Mendelssohn. As we listen, the family will come forward to light candles. Led by Daniel, they'll take their lights from the central candle, which represents Jesus, the light of the world. And their individual candles represent the spread of that light and love, and their loving thoughts and ours and memories of Ian. Jill.
This reflective prayer was given to me by a friend. I prayed it with Ian on his last morning. It was just what we needed. And now I want to share it and its comforting and reassuring thoughts with all of you. I am the Lord of love, the Lord of peace. I am the one who is moving gently, leading, drawing on into all that is new and good and lovely. All that I have for you is good. All that you need is available now. Do not rush, do not fret, do not panic. Just rest and wait, and wait and rest. Let the water flow on, carrying you. Leave it all to me, for I am the God who comes gently to you. I am the Lord who loves you deeply. I died. I went through Gethsemane for you. How can I lead you into death now? No, I am the Lord of life, and I lead you on into new and wonderfully green pastures. There is no need to struggle anymore. Just step on gently in my love. I have you by the hand. I am not rushing you. We will go together into tomorrow, and all the tomorrows I am with you. Trust me, for I cannot let you go.
Thank you.
Now Joshua is going to read from Holy Scripture.
Do not be worried and upset, Jesus told them. Believe in God and believe also in me. There are many rooms in my Father's house, and I'm going to prepare a place for you. I would not tell you this if it were not so. And after I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to myself, so that you will be where I am. You know the way that leads to the place where I'm going. Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you are going, so how can we know the way to get there? Jesus answered him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one goes to the Father except by me. It's from John 14, 1-6.
Thank you. You stand to sing the hymn, The Servant King. Be seated. Jill, Joanna, Michael, and Carol have given a very vivid and eloquent picture of Ian's life among us. And there is always so much more to tell. Stories of a man who was much loved, Stories we all have, and which I hope will be shared after this service in the hall over refreshments. But I, for one, wonder how many times Ian sat in this very church, his family church, and heard the passage which Joshua read for us from Holy Scripture. In my relatively short time here as vicar, Ian and Jill have shown great determination to get to church whenever possible, overcoming in recent years a multitude of obstacles and health scares. Hearing difficulties, as indeed we showed right at the beginning of this service by forgetting to turn the microphone on, and technical difficulties during the pandemic. But why? Why did church matter so much to Ian? Was it the social life of the church which mattered most? I don't think so. And yet, once here, they certainly played their part in the fellowship of the church, becoming lifelong friends with many and getting involved in many of the church organisations, as we've heard, but especially friendship teas, which they ran, Pray Hemel and Baptism Prep. Or was it the music? We know Ian liked to sing. Possibly. Ian was a keen supporter of our choir and the musical life, and music in general. But I think there was more to it than that. And you could see it in the way he, up until the start of the pandemic, would resolutely make his way up to the high altar behind me, to the rail, and kneel down to receive the Blessed Sacrament, despite the fear of not being able to get back up again. In fact, even up to a couple of months ago, he would kneel in the front pews to receive the sacrament at the Wednesday 10 o'clock communion, with his legs in unbearable pain. You could see it in the way he approached this lectern, with beautifully crafted, thoughtful, and prayer-prepared intercessions for the congregation to join in and make their own. You could see it in the way his eyes sparkled with joy on hearing the Easter acclamation, Alleluia, Christ is risen, and he would respond with thunderous joy, He is risen indeed, Alleluia. That was what church was about for Ian. To be in his Heavenly Father's presence and receive from the Lord of all life, who, as we've just heard in our reading, declared himself to be the way, the truth, and the life. Ian knew this to his very core. He knew this from his youth until his final breath. He knew that through faith in the living God, in Jesus Christ, he had found the way to eternal life. He believed and trusted in Jesus' promise to go and prepare a place for him in that glorious kingdom where sins had been forgiven and death is no more. And that all this has been made possible through Jesus' death and resurrection, and that the gates of heaven have been flung wide open through the overwhelming love and grace of God. Ian's faith in the resurrection was steadfast and sure, an inspiration to those around him and a gentle reassurance for those who were wavering. But Ian's faith wasn't just a personal matter for him. Yes, it was something he treasured, but it was also something he wanted and needed to share. Perhaps it is no coincidence that he died on the Feast of the Annunciation, the day the angel Gabriel greeted Mary and invited her to be the mother of our Lord and Saviour Jesus Christ. For Ian, like Gabriel, was a messenger, a herald of glad tidings. Ian never missed an opportunity to live the values of the kingdom and to drop into conversation the love of God as revealed in Jesus dying on the cross to enable our forgiveness. And although he may not have looked like our modern understanding of an angel, he certainly had angelic traits. For he was a herald of good news, a help in times of need, a servant of God, and counted among those who assemble around God's throne, giving praise and honour. It is right, therefore, that we gather in this holy place, which Ian knew so well, where saints and angels dwell with us mere humans, to celebrate his life and give thanks to God for all that made him that unique and wonderful person. We do so cherishing our memories, whilst acknowledging that we cannot make any new ones with him. We rejoice that he has joined his fellow saints and angels in the halls of heaven, where he now sees his Lord and Saviour face to face. Yet we grieve with pain and sadness his passing and the loss of someone so influential in our lives. We cry because of the depth of affection we shared. We laugh as we remember the happier times. We say goodbye, knowing that our parting is not infinite, but rather that, trusting in the sure and certain hope of the resurrection, we will meet again on another shore. We know Ian trusted in the reality of God's new kingdom, and in faith we are invited to do likewise. The road to that kingdom may not always be easy. We may get a little lost. We may get scared. But throughout it all, Christ the Good Shepherd will be there, guiding and leading us, as the psalmist reminds us. Today, we may think that Ian's death is the end, but it isn't. It's the beginning of a new adventure for him, and one in which we will soon partake. Let us therefore celebrate his release from pain and suffering. Celebrate his love and joy in living. Celebrate his unique nature and personality. Celebrate his unerring faith, confident that the choirs of angels are leading him into paradise with our Heavenly Father. And celebrate his trust in the resurrection. For alleluia, Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia. So we stand to sing the hymn, O Jesus, I Have Promised.
O Jesus, I have promised to serve thee to the end. Be thou forever near me, my master and my friend. I shall not fear a battle if thou art by my side. Oh, wonder from halfway, if thou wilt be my guide. Let me hear thee speaking in accents clear and still, above the storms of passion, the murmurs of self-will. Oh, speak to reassure me, to hasten home.
To our time of prayer, we sit or kneel to pray. God of mercy and Lord of life, you have made us in your image to reflect your truth and light. We give you thanks for Ian, for the grace and mercy he received from you, for all that was good in his life, and for the memories we treasure today. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Father, you promised eternal life to those who believe. Remember for good this your servant Ian, as we also remember him. Bring Ian with all who rest in Christ into the fullness of your kingdom, where sins have been forgiven and death is no more. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Father, your mighty power brings joy out of grief and life out of death. Look in your mercy on Ian's family and friends, and all who mourn him. Give them patient faith in times of darkness, and strengthen them with the knowledge of your love. Lord, in your mercy. Father, you are tender towards your children, and your mercy is over all your works. Heal any memories of hurt and failure, and give us the wisdom and grace to use aright the time that is left to us here on earth. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We join all our prayers together in the prayer which Jesus himself taught, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Our next hymn was often sung at baptisms, which Ian and Jill were on duty for and had prepared the families for. And it became a prayer for Ian. So we're going to sing Give Me Joy in My Heart as a prayer.
Give me joy in my heart, keep me praising. Give me joy in my heart, I pray. Give me joy in my heart, keep me praising. Keep me praising till the break of day. Sing Hosanna, sing Hosanna, sing Hosanna to the King of Kings. Sing Hosanna, sing Hosanna, sing Hosanna to the King. Give me peace in my heart, keep me loving. Give me peace in my heart, I
Sing Hosanna to the King of Kings. Sing Hosanna, sing Hosanna, sing Hosanna to the King. Give me love in my heart, keep me serving. Give me love in my heart, I pray. Give me love in my heart, keep me serving. Keep me serving till the break of day. Sing Hosanna, sing Hosanna, sing Hosanna to the King of Kings. Sing Hosanna, sing Hosanna, sing Hosanna to the King.
Hear what comfortable words our Saviour Christ saith unto all that truly turn to him. Come unto me, all that travail and are heavy laden, and I will refresh you. So God loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, to the end that all that believe in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Hear also what St. Paul saith. This is a true saying, and worthy of all men to be received, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. Hear also what St. John said. If any man sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous, and he is the propitiation for our sins.
And he's going to read to us the poem, The Legacy.
When I die, give what is left of me to others. If you need to cry, cry for your brothers walking beside you. Put your arms around anyone and give them what you need to give to me. I want to leave you with something, something better than words or sounds. Look for me in the people I have known and loved, and if you cannot live without me, then let me live on in your eyes, your mind, and your acts of kindness. You can love me most by letting hands touch hands and letting go of others who need to be free. Love does not die. People do. It's when all that is left of me is love. Give me away.
Thank you. We stand to sing our final hymn, Lord of All Hopefulness.
Thank you.
Let us commend Ian to the mercy of God, our Maker and Redeemer. God, our Creator and Redeemer, by your power, Christ conquered death and entered into glory. Confident of his victory and claiming his promises, we entrust Ian to your mercy. In the name of Jesus our Lord, who died and is alive and reigns with you, now and forever. Amen. Amen. Go forth upon your journey from this world, O Christian soul. In the name of God the Father Almighty, who created you, in the name of Jesus Christ, who suffered death for you, in the name of the Holy Spirit, who strengthens you, in communion with Mary and all the blessed saints, and aided by the angels and archangels and all the armies of a heavenly host. Ian, may your portion be this day in peace, and your dwelling the heavenly Jerusalem. Amen. So we have entrusted our brother Ian to God's mercy, and we now commit his body to be cremated. Earth to earth, ashes to ashes, dust to dust, in sure and certain hope of the resurrection to eternal life through our Lord Jesus Christ, who will transform our frail bodies that we may be conformed to his glorious body. He died, was buried, and rose again for us. Him be glory forever and ever. Amen. Amen. May the road rise to meet you. May the wind be always at your back. May the sun shine warm upon your face, the rains fall soft upon your fields. And until we meet again, may God hold you in the palm of his hand. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always. Amen. Amen.